between 1945 and 1992, the United States performed over 1,000 nuclear tests. Out of those, 216 were space underwater or atmospheric tests. While most of the testing took place at a test site in Nevada, the United States military tested the capabilities of these new weapons and other places as well, particularly within the Pacific Ocean. With such immense power in their hands, you would assume the scientists would take extra precautions to ensure innocent bystanders were not negatively impacted from the nuclear warheads detonating nearby. However, mistakes happen in every line of work. And there have been several cases where nuclear testing went horribly off the rails. While there have only been a few tests gone awry, one error is one to many when you're dealing with nuclear weapons. It is estimated that because of nuclear weapons testing in the United States, over 300,000 Americans have lost their lives. On March 1, 1954, a group of military officers, scientists, Marshall Island natives, and fishermen gathered on a small island to witness the testing of a new nuclear weapon. The testing was codenamed Castle Bravo, and its impact almost led to the deaths of them all. The experiment was designed to test the first thermonuclear explosion that was based on feasible technology. The goal was that this research would result in a deliverable H-bomb. The team designed a prototype watt-fuel bomb that was based on the IB Mike weapon designed just a couple of years earlier. The bomb in question weighed 30 tons despite only measuring 5 feet wide and... However, this bomb simply wasn't practical, which is why for Castle Bravo, they used dry fuel consisting of lithium deuteron, which is solid and more lightweight. Scientists estimated that Castle Bravo would yield an explosion of roughly 5 megatons. With this in mind, they based where the safety zone would be where people could watch the explosion and remain a safe distance away. Castle Bravo was set to go off at 6:45 local time, and from the second to detonated, onlookers knew something had gone terribly wrong. The nuclear explosion produced an overwhelming flash even brighter than what scientists expected from nuclear blasts. The blast was so bright that men were able to see their bones appear as shadows through their own flesh. Blinding light made its way through every crack and pinhole within the secured facilities. The thermal radiation from the blast was far more intense than they were anticipating. Sailors on Navy ships over 30 miles away were reported as saying that it felt like a blowtorch was being directed right at their bodies. The subsequent shockwave destroyed buildings far outside. They calculated damages on the fireball forming from the explosion measured at roughly 4 miles in diameter and rose over 130,000 feet above sea level. Oh, and did I mention that it was hotter than the surface of the sun? Men who fought valiantly in World War II fell to their knees and began to pray. Remember when we said that scientists expected the blast to only be 5 megatons? Well, when all was said and done, that blast was closer to 15 megatons. The reason for the miscalculation was due to a tritium bonus that happened in the middle of the thermonuclear reaction, cascading neutrons, and the bomb turned the lithium-7 isotope into a mix of tritium and helium. And if you know nothing of thermonuclear dynamics, then you should know that tritium creates extreme energetic fusion. This blast was 1,000 times greater than the atomic bomb dropped on Hiroshima. And just when everyone in the vicinity thought they were safe, there was the matter of the nuclear fallout. Meteorologists expected the fallout to blow away from all inhabited areas. Instead, the opposite occurred, with a radioactive cloud blowing the fallout toward the population. It rained down on nearby ships as well as United States service members stationed on Roderick Island. The fallout also made its way to a Japanese fishing vessel, where one man died from radiation exposure, resulting in an international disaster between the US and Japan. More so, Marshall Island natives had to leave the only home they had ever known because the radiation. They returned briefly but had to evacuate again due to fears of lingering radiation, and they never went back. Fallout continued in the form of extensive legislation to limit further testing of nuclear weapons. In 1963, the US passed the Limited Test Ban Treaty that outlawed any further atmospheric testing of nuclear weapons. In 1990, Congress passed the Radiation Exposure Compensation Act, which stated that the Justice Department would offer a one-time payment of $75,000 to any and all atomic veterans for nuclear testing-related illnesses. Surprisingly, records show that only about 3% of such atomic veterans have ever filed for a claim. Due to atmospheric testing being banned, the military and scientists had to go underground if they wanted to test the capabilities of nuclear weapons. One such test known as the BANEBERRY test was scheduled to occur at 7:30 a.m. on December 18, 1970. The test was located at a Nevada test site. The bomb was lowered more than 900 feet into a hole a little over 7 feet in diameter. It only took about 3 minutes after the test began for people to realize that something had gone horrifically wrong. Nearly 300 feet away from the hole where the bomb was planted, a fissure opened up in the ground. This fissure was just large enough to where a cloud of radioactive vapor and dust began pouring into the sky. Government workers immediately had to evacuate from the test site. But when you're dealing with a nuclear bomb, you don't exactly have a lot of time. Hundreds of them ended up being exposed to the radiation. For many of the workers, their exposure remained within the established safety limits. However, two men who had suffered from the highest levels of exposure out of anyone later contracted leukemia and passed away. Their widows fought for compensation for years. While courts ultimately found the government to be negligent in this case, it found that they were not liable and no money was awarded. The government also ended up doing a test to determine why this went wrong. They halted all underground testing for 6 months, and eventually, it was discovered that the geology of the site, along with its high water content, ultimately magnified the impact of the bomb. New rules were put into place regarding the investigation of geology of potential test sites before moving forward. Additionally, new rules had to be put into place to limit workers' potential exposure to radiation in the future. In the above two examples, there were terrifying pictures of what these blasts looked like. However, ultimately, the blast isn't what ended up killing anyone. People remained at safe distances from the detonations. And while things went wrong, no one was near the blast site. The real killer came in the form of radioactive fallout. The last nuclear testing occurred in the 1990s. And for good reason. New research has revealed that there has always been a hidden cost of developing nuclear weapons, and it's in the form of numerous American deaths between 1951 and 1973. It's estimated that anywhere between 340,600 and 91,000 Americans died as a result of nuclear fallout in their own country between 1951 and 1963. The US tested nuclear weapons above ground, inadvertently exposing thousands of workers to fallout in high doses. This fallout is deadly to humans, and even in low doses, it can still lead to cancer. The emissions did not remain localized at the test site. Instead, wind blew the fallout into local communities. Over time, it was revealed that towns near nuclear testing sites had significantly higher rates of cancer. When compared to other cities, much causes could be as high as 690,000. It seems as though the United States killed more of its own people to develop these weapons. The government has taken steps to reduce the number of people exposed to radioactive materials. Additionally, there was some blind luck associated with reducing the number of poisoned individuals. A great deal of nuclear testing occurred in Nevada, which had a low atmosphere dispersal rate, meaning the fallout was less likely to make its way to nearby communities. The government was actually looking at other testing facilities before decided on Nevada, and it turns out that decision could have saved hundreds upon thousands of lives. Unfortunately, the impact of these tests lingers in American society. It's entirely plausible that millions of Americans were exposed to fallout and suffer from illnesses related to that exposure. Those people now rely on the government to fund health care. Nuclear testing has fallen to the wayside, with the last test occurring in 1992. This was due to the adoption of the Comprehensive Nuclear Test Ban Treaty that was created by the United Nations General Assembly. This treaty bans all nuclear explosions for both military and civilian purposes. The treaty has not entered into force, with 8 nations not yet ratifying. Nuclear weapons have a complicated spot in history.